have a favorite animal? I went through many favorite animals when I was a kid. The velvet ant, the sea pig, silky bantam chickens. Okay, that one might actually still be my favorite. What I loved most, though, was collecting facts about different animals. I mean, I really enjoyed it. I could tell you how much a silky bantam chicken weighs, on average, or where you would find a sea pig. But of course, one fact to always know about your favorite animal is what your favorite animal eats. Are they herbivores, which means they eat plants? Carnivores, which means they eat meat? Omnivores, which means they eat meat and plants? And there are more categories than this. Even though all my favorite animals ate different things, they all had one thing in common. They were all heterotrophs. Generally, animals are heterotrophs, which means they consume organic matter. It doesn't matter whether they are eating plants, meat, or both. They are heterotrophs, also known as consumers. Along with animals being heterotrophs, so are fungi, some protists are heterotrophs, and some bacteria, and some archaea too. But not everything on this planet is a heterotroph. Do you have a favorite plant? That may be less popular than having a favorite animal. Plants are generally autotrophs, which means they make their own food. To be more specific, they make organic substances, such as glucose, from inorganic substances, such as carbon dioxide. If talking about plants, their source of energy to do this is light. Plants are also known as producers. Their food is glucose, an organic substance which they produce in the process of photosynthesis by using inorganic substances such as carbon dioxide. Oh, and even the plants known as carnivorous plants still produce their own food using photosynthesis. It's just that carnivorous plants can also digest insects to obtain nitrogen. Nitrogen is an important element that living organisms need, and it turns out that most carnivorous plants live in areas where there is low nitrogen in the soil. Along with plants, some protists are autotrophs. Some bacteria and some archaea are too. Now, it's also possible that an organism itself can be both an autotroph and a heterotroph. In our protist video, we talk about Euglena. Euglena can do photosynthesis as autotrophs, but they can also be heterotrophs and consume organic matter in cases where light is not available. So far, we've been pretty general with showing examples of heterotrophs and autotrophs. But what if I told you that it can get a lot fancier? And we're going to go into some more depth, but we want to point out that you can still get into more depth than we'll be getting into. Check out the further reading details for more. And as always, there are fascinating exceptions in biology that we can't include in such a short video. So we gave a general description that autotrophs make their own food. That is, they make organic substances from inorganic substances, and heterotrophs instead must consume food, meaning they must consume organic substances. If you remember from our biomolecules video, the molecules that make up life, they all have carbon. So the source for carbon is important. Autotrophs and heterotrophs obtain carbon differently. Autotrophs generally use an inorganic source of carbon to make their food. Heterotrophs instead must get their carbon from organic sources that they consume. But there are also other terms here. Photo, meaning light, and chemo, meaning chemical. Instead of the carbon sources, these terms refer to the organism's energy source. So when we've been talking about plants, a plant is an example of a photoautotroph, because a plant uses light as an energy source. But not all autotrophs use light as an energy source. Have you ever heard of the deep sea vents? I'll never forget learning about these when I was a kid. I used to think, how can anything live down there with the lack of light? Plus the substances there, like hydrogen sulfide, which is something that can be dangerous to many other organisms, and the extreme temperatures. There's still life down there. Bacteria that are chemoautotrophs are a great example. They are autotrophs as they can make their own food. Recall that is making organic substances from inorganic substances. But their energy source is chemical, hence the name chemoautotroph. They can oxidize inorganic substances like that hydrogen sulfide we mentioned. For chemoautotrophs, the chemical they use depends on the species, but no light required. So we know humans are heterotrophs. Humans, as well as other animals, are examples of chemoheterotrophs. Humans, as well as other animals, have to consume organic matter, and it is also organic compounds that act as their energy source. Okay, that leaves one more, right? We had chemoheterotrophs, photoautotrophs, chemoautotrophs, and we're missing photoheterotrophs. This one has always been a bit challenging for me to wrap my mind around. They are heterotrophs, which means they do consume organic matter. But that photo prefix means their energy source is light, which they require. This mode of nutrition is found in a few types of prokaryotes. Now, it's important to mention that these organisms will do some form of cellular respiration to further break down their food to generate ATP. And by food, it can be food that was consumed, like heterotrophs, or food that they produce themselves, like autotrophs. However, cellular respiration processes can vary. The process may involve oxygen, or no oxygen, different electron acceptors. It's exciting, and it's in some different videos. Overall, the beauty of how organisms obtain what they need to survive just continues to amaze us. Well, that's it for the Amoeba Sisters, and we remind you to stay curious.